Just a young gun with a quick fuse. I was uptight, wanna let loose. I was dreaming of bigger things and wanna leave my old life behind. Not a yes sir, not a follower. I was lightning before the thunder.
Thunder, 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 thunder.
Welcome to Reality Insight with Nancy Hopkins. Produced by Cosmic Reality Radio. Welcome to Reality Insight. I'm recording this on April 18th, 2018. My name is Nancy Hopkins, and I hope you like that new intro. It's by Imagine Dragons. It's called Thunder. And for me, that particular song represents the energy frequency which I have been living in for the last few months. Well, since the beginning of 2018. Maybe that's the theme song of 2018. I was lightning before the thunder. What's that mean to me? Well, on Tuesdays, between noon and 2, we have a radio show called the Shungite Show. And we had a young lady on there who, I'm 70, so she's half my age, named Indigo Crow. And she was very much aware of the impact my generation, the 60s generation, had on her reality. And she had come to an understanding of what it must have taken for my generation to have continued looking for the truth under the powerful attempt to mind control us. And the fact that there were only a few of us, we didn't have access to the internet, we were doing it by ourselves, and we were very lonely. I wasn't really lonely because I seemed to be able to track people that kind of were into my own thing, or they just put up with me. I'm not sure what it was, but I didn't feel the isolation that so many of my generation did, who were, quote, light workers. Now, lightning before the thunder. Lightning. We were the flash of light in a growing matrix of control over our minds. We were the ones that said, what's this war in Vietnam all about? We were the ones that looked for messiahs, that tested all sorts of hallucinogenic and other drugs in order to see, is there more to life? We were a generation that, for the most part, had been shattered by the Kennedy assassination. Reality had shattered. Our minds were much less inclined to be controlled, to believe what we had been taught to believe, because in the end, you shattered all that with, you know, an assassin's bullet. So the generation itself was primed to not buy into it. But our parents, many of our older siblings, younger siblings, I mean, they were also in part involved in the shattering of reality. But the difference was they had invested in that reality. They needed jobs. They were programmed to think in a certain way. It was just that at my age group, we were making the transition from youth into adults. And I've said this before, the mind of a child becomes the mind of an adult the moment they ask a question that nobody can answer. And that happened on November 23rd, 1963, when they killed Kennedy. Nobody could answer. Why? Why would this have happened? Everything was going along fine. All of a sudden, this has happened. It was really reality shaking. So my generation didn't have anything invested in the reality that was presented to us. It was much easier for us to say, bullshit. Because we didn't need jobs. We had parents that were putting us through school. I'm not talking about everybody. I'm talking about me. So what I want to do here is I want to tell you about that generation. Because Indy Crow said to me, you know, thank you for being who you were and what you did. But she also went on to say, and thank you for telling the stories. Because the reality is that the rest of the world has a perception of the 60s people, which is fairly accurate, I guess. I'll explain why I'm only guessing. But the reality is that generations of knowledge is being hidden, is being covered up, is being written out of history. And so last week I did an hour of storytelling, and then I did an hour of researching or discussing the research of Dan Willis. And Reverend Lee Brown said to me, well, I liked the first hour, but the second hour was not so good, because she liked the storytelling. So I thought about it, and I said, you know, and then I ran into Indigo Crow, and she said, you know, the story. And I realized there's, you know, Dan Willis had done the research. Yes, I was trying to promote the knowledge. Yes, I wanted to comment on the knowledge. But the reality is he had done the research. Others have done the research. Other people you can go to get the research. But you can't get my story anyplace else except for me. And my story is not my story alone. It's a story of my generation. And I'm doing this for my generation, but also for you people that don't know what really happened. How'd we get here? What was the transitional period? Not to find fault, but to find history. If we don't know where we came from, we certainly do not know where we are. So I'm going to start this show, and I'm going to start telling my story, and we'll go show after show until my story is told or I get another host. For many Thanksgivings, and I grew up in Massachusetts, okay, so for every, not when I was a kid, but later on when I understood more about genetics and stuff like that. So for many, many years now, every Thanksgiving when I get together with people, I tell them about how it all started with the Plymouth Colony and the Indians and the Pilgrims, the Bay Colony people get together and they have this this feast, and that becomes the beginning of the Thanksgiving thing. And that was all because of the Mayflower, and that my family was, you know, directly descended from the Mayflower, because Stephen Hopkins had a son, Oceanus Hopkins, and he was the one that everybody talked about. But I was actually kind of lying, because I had no proof of it. But just looking at the time that they were there, and the distance that the Hopkins family went, I suspected that it had to be in and around the time of the Mayflower. It didn't make sense that it was anything else. So after a bit, I decided I probably ought to see if I'm lying or not. And so I went and I researched it, and I honestly could not find a direct connection between my family and Stephen Hopkins on the Mayflower. So it would have been dropped there, except that I end up working with Colleen Kelly, who's the producer for Haggy Shack, and she's also into researching genealogy, ancestry, and she really likes it, and she's very good at it. So she gets on the hunt, and she tells me things that I didn't know. Now, the reason I'm starting with the Mayflower is because so many of you guys have families that link back to the same time and some of the same influences that might have been there. And I'm not going to remember it. I'm not doing research. Remember, I'm just telling stories. So, Colleen, if I get it wrong, well, you know, let me know. Okay, so what happens is that when you got the Stephen Hopkins on the Mayflower, the reason it's remembered and there's a lot of notoriety concerning it is because of his son Oceanus Hopkins, who was born on the Mayflower. Now, one of the things that seems to have slipped from my memory or from history is that Oceanus died very shortly after he was born. He didn't survive. I didn't know that. I never much thought, well, what happened to Oceanus? But I guess Colleen set me straight, he died. So when you go back and you're looking for information on the Mayflower, there's actually very little. But the Stephen Hopkins story is something that quite a few families have linked into. But like I say, I didn't see it happening for ours. Well, it turns out, Colleen says, that when you have one family member on a ship, I think that they don't have the manifest, the who was on the ship. That's what I think is the problem. But when you have one family member that you know is on a ship, it's very likely that there's another family member. Because when they would leave the old country to come to the new country, it was very, very often, I don't know if it was all the time or the majority of the time, probably not all the time, but they would come with brothers or sisters. And it would be a family move, more so than just individuals, you know, getting on a boat and going. So if there was Stephen Hopkins, then what other Hopkins could be there? And she figures out a link to one of those Hopkinses, somebody was on the Mayflower, but not directly. She's still, I think, like one out. She got the son, but she's not sure about the father. But anyway, same time frame. Now, what's really interesting about this that she taught me was that let's step back a minute. The town that I grew up in is called Oxford. Supposedly that's where the ox forded the river, and there is a river there, a small river, so possibly that's the reason for it. But Oxford in and of itself has a really interesting history, because what we had back in those colonial days were people coming out of the old countries because of economic reasons, for one, for sure, and for religious reasons. They were being they were being put down. Persecuted. That's the word. Persecuted. And so a lot of them left because of religious, you know, they wanted religious freedom. The pilgrims are pointed to for that reason, of course. One of the groups that came over here for religious reasons, because they were being persecuted, were the Huguenots. And my understanding is that the religion started in France, but then got into trouble there and sort of went over, migrated to Britain, and then got into trouble there, and so then they finally decided to leave and come to the New World. And the first establishment of the Huguenot settlement in the New, I don't know if it was the first, but I think it is, was in Oxford, Massachusetts. And when they got there, they built a fort right on top of the highest hill. I think it's the highest hill. There's a few hills in the area. Massachusetts is, you know, hilly. Not mountainous, but hilly. And we were in the kind of the central area of the state. So it's flat land and hilly. As you get closer to the east side of the state, it gets flatter and flatter because you're going towards the ocean. So I grew up in a town where you had a monument to the Huguenots, and you also had a monument to the Johnson family that had been all killed by the Native Americans. So, and Mom would take us up there, my family, because remember, I'm the oldest of 10. But she'd take us up there, and we would gather Concord grapes, because when the Huguenots got there, they planted Concord grapes. And I didn't get the full impact of eating grapes, that the vines are, you know, a couple hundred years old, until, of course, I was an adult and could understand age. As a kid, you're going like, oh, cool. But she would take us up there, and I don't think anybody else in town knew about this place, because we'd go up there and we would pick all of these Concord grapes. I mean, just huge amounts of them, and she'd take them back to the house, and then she'd cook them all down and make jam out of them. So to this day, Concord grapes are my most favorite thing in the world, and when they show up here down here in Florida, I eat a lot of Concord grapes because it's nostalgic too. You know, it's something that we did with Mom and all that good stuff. But later on, I don't remember ever finding anything, but later on, my brothers, Mark and Mike, the twins, they were basically now on their own, but they were up there, and they were searching around because the foundation of the fort was still there. And they did find some very old pieces, like a belt buckle and something else. I don't remember what it was. Don't even know what happened to them. So the Huguenots come into Oxford, and they were a religion in and of themselves. But this movement of religious people into an area and then creating a community around them was not just limited to the Huguenots. The thing that made me kind of like chuckle and shake my head was, all right, you get the pilgrims that come over here because they want religious freedom. Well, apparently they really, really wanted religious freedom, because most of the movement at that time in the population was people in the congregation who disagreed with what the religion was being presented as, and saying, you, and they take off with their family and maybe some friends and maybe some other people that think the same way. And they go off to some new place and set up a church, and then the community grows around that. So from the get-go, a lot of the movement through from the, you know, the original beach landings into the New England area was based on continually searching for religious freedom. Okay, so that's basically how that all started happening. And you got more and more people coming in, and, you know, then the cities start to get built up, New York, Boston. But not Oxford. Oxford always stayed a very small town. We'll talk about that later, but small town. But what was then fascinating is, the family Hopkins shows up in New York State, central New York State, where it's called Cortland, New York, where it is got bigger hills. It's something more like what I would think it's seeing in Germany or something. I mean, bigger hills going into mountainous stuff. Contained. It didn't have a lot of roads going to it or from it, and I don't know why it even existed. I don't know why some of these little towns exist, you know, but it's probably because there's churches there. So they get to Cortland and into the New York area, and that's when Colleen's story starts up again because, and this was fascinating, what happened was that during the Revolutionary War, a lot of the colonists joined the army, Revolutionary Army. But there was no money. There was no taxes. There was no money to pay them. So they were given the promise that if they fought with the army, that they would be given a certain amount of land when the war ended. Now, of course, they're taking a chance that the Americans are going to win. But again, there's a sense of incredible courage to fight for freedom. Now, some of you have heard my stories about the American Revolution, but I'm not going to get into that. Not this time, anyway. But let's just say that the people were forced into a situation of really rebelling to save themselves. And so in many cases it was the concept of, I need to do this for salvation. to survive. So there was a tremendous amount of energy and emotion in that war. And I'm talking about energies because wherever we go, we leave pieces of our energy signature there. It's just what happens. Remember, there is no time per se. It's we're moving. Everything is moving, and so we're changing position. And when we change position, we change our relationship to energy. Einstein finally came. I don't know if it's Einstein because he doesn't seem to like quantum physics. It's all probably somebody else. But I remember it as Einstein saying, "Energy is. Reality is energy in relationship to itself." What that means is that if you encounter an energy form, it's going to do certain things to your energy form. You're going to do certain things to that energy form. And we're always changing position, always, always, always. So when you have a war that is being fought on American ground, in your backyard, you can only imagine the kind of emotions that are actually permeating the soil. So when we were growing up, in an environment of patriotism, in an energy field of people sacrificed for us. It wasn't just the energy field, it was the history of the state. And the state was very proud of itself. It was one of the first states to declare itself independent from England. It was one of the 13 original colonies that became the American Revolutionary Forces. So we were not alone, but I can tell you that, you know, from my perspective, alone that there were other areas of the country that also encountered this kind of energy. But in my case, it was basically Revolutionary War, back to the war. So the people that were fighting, they were given this promise of going to New York area. Well, they didn't. I don't think they specified it. We'll give you some land. So after the war, there was a long time before these people ever saw this promise kept. But in fact, it was kept, in that the federal government bought up, probably, you know, who knows how they got it, because it took a long time to basically get the Native Americans living in the New York State area to leave or to give over their land so that they could then give it to these ex-soldiers. And Colleen said that it took so long that a lot of them died before they ever got it. Some of them actually sold it before they ever got it. And I don't remember now how much land, but there was an appreciable amount of land. But so what you see is that after the Revolutionary War and after this time frame where they're trying to get this land, then you get a whole influx of these soldier people that and families that are moving into this area, and apparently that's where the Hopkinses moved to. That's why they were drawn to Cortland. In that area was free land, because many of them must have been involved with being in the Revolutionary War as soldiers for the American forces. So that's where I'm going to pick up the story. My mom and dad, both of them grew up in Cortland, New York. My mom was the daughter of Philip Vormwald and his wife, who was Mary, what was her name? Nellie O'Connor. Connor. Oh gosh, I don't even remember. Isn't that funny? I don't know why I have a problem with that. O'Connor or Connor. Well, I think it comes from it because I ended up having a sister who had a son named Connor. And I think I knew it might have been O'Connor before I met Connor, and now it's Connor. Well, anyway, back to the story. And those guys were German and Irish descent. Grandma Nell was Irish, and Grandpa Phil was German. an interesting combination that turned out to be visible in my mother, because I think she had stubborn streaks from both of those people. The stubborn streak in the German that, you know, keeps them very focused and doing what they're doing. And then on the side of the Irish, it's this attitude of, I can do it myself. And both of those traits I can say I saw in my mom. So she had, let's see, there was her sister Mary and her sister Patricia Pat. Pat became a Catholic nun. She had a brother Glenn. He became a Catholic priest. The oldest in the family was Phil, but he died. He died in his adulthood. He had a family and stuff. So I never really knew him. I did know my cousins and my aunt. And then my Uncle Paul. And so you've got that rather large and very, very Catholic family. And then there's my dad. And he's a Hopkins, of course. And I'll tell you about my grandmother and grandfather, his mom and dad. Because as distant I was from my mom's family, and that's her parents, and that's probably because they had a lot of kids, you know. But my grandma and grandpa Hopkins, Alda and Lynn, they had only two kids, my Aunt Peg and my dad. My dad was the older. So when I came along, I was like, ooh, I was special, because I was the oldest, their first grandchild. But I also had a real affinity for these two. They loved me in ways that I don't believe my parents had the strength to do or the time to do. And so many summers I would spend weeks out with them. And I could go on and on about I have a lot of memories from being with them. Because it was different, because it was special, because I felt special. I was certainly, I never felt fear in my childhood. I was not, we didn't get brought up at all that way. Well, maybe a little fearful of Dad. And one time I saw Grandpa really mad. He kind of put me in a state of fear. But they were my window into another generation, a generation before my mom and dad, their generation. And we didn't do it very often, but we did it, you know, at least once while I was there every summer. We would take a little trip in the car, and it was an old Pontiac. Well, they had a number of different cars, but the one I really remember was this old big Pontiac. And back then, which we're talking now in the 50s, you don't have a lot of roads, because I was born in 48. So you don't have a lot of roads, tarred roads and all that. You have your main thoroughfares, and then you've got a lot of dirt roads up in New York. And so you'd be in this car, and they'd be going over this dirt road, and the car would fill up with dust. It was terrible in the back seat. But it was also a lot of fun. And I remember them taking me to this, it was just basically a foundation on the side of the road. And we got out. There was nobody around. It was farmland. And we got out of the car and walked around. And that was their single building school. That all the kids went to that school, no matter what your age was. And they would get there by wagon sometimes during the, when there wasn't snow. They had to ski when there was snow, unless they, you know, could get through with the wagons. But buses and this kind of concept, no. I mean, because they live quite a bit of ways. Sometimes they'd be forced to walk. But the idea from my little childlike mind of all these kids going, and it was a small house. I mean, it's smaller than the one I live in. And you had all these different kids there, but I guess there wasn't probably very many of them. But that was the education that my grandpa and grandma got. And grandpa turned out to be working for is a maintenance person for, what's the name of it? It has a bulldog as its logo. In the trucks, he was always working in a garage fixing trucks. So needless to say, especially in the closed up winter times, he and I suspect everybody else that worked there ended up with lung cancer because of the fumes and everything. This was part of the industrialization and a lot of these accidental things that nobody knew about that you could, you know, have many, many shows on those subjects. Things that they thought were safe that weren't. But Grandpa was an amazing man. Now, I understand that there was, when he was younger, that he used to beat at least my father. Maybe my grandmother. Nobody sort of seems to be talking about that. But he did seem to, he was a drinker. He was probably a frustrated human being. And he was a drinker, and he'd get drunk, and he would become a violent drunk. Until the day that, I guess he was going either after my aunt or my mother, my grandma. My father was old enough as a teenager to fight back, and he actually smacked Grandpa. And what I understand is Grandpa never tried it again. So I'm not suggesting you smack somebody, but, you know, sometimes maybe that's what it takes. But to me, I never saw any of that. I found that out when I was really old. I mean, I didn't have any concept that this man who was so loving and caring and seemed to love my grandmother, unbelievably love her. I mean, I would watch him look at her and you could feel the love. I didn't exactly know that as a kid, but I mean, it was always such a pleasant thing to be with them. In the back of their house, they had this, I bet they were on, they must have been on at least an acre of land. And in the back of the house, they had a farm that Grandpa put up. And along the one side of it, there were all these berries, you know, blackberries and raspberries. And then he had carrots and corn and lettuce and, you know, all the things you'd put in a regular old garden. And I have to say the garden was fun. A lot of good things in it, especially the berries. But he also kept chickens, and that was not so much fun because that's what they really ate a lot of, was their own chickens. They would get the eggs, but they also, you know, euthanized the chickens. And I didn't like that. I seriously did not like that. I think one time I may have seen my grandfather do the deed, because it seems to be there, but I'm sure if I did it once, I never did it again. But we don't like to think about the chickens, because Grandma and Grandpa also had popcorn. They'd grow corn, I think it was special corn that would pop. And to see popcorn from the garden popping, I'm not even sure that we had popcorn at the time. I'm not sure, because it just seemed to be such an amazing thing to have this popcorn. They taught me, I guess, what it was to be their age with little education and just basic human beings. But that's only because they took me back and showed me where they lived. Grandpa also grew up on a farm. And his brother was still working the farm. It was dairy cows. I think it was, I'm sure they had garden, but, you know, they also had dairy cows. And their mother was still alive. Now, this woman must have been in her 90s, I think, at least. You know, she was older than old to me as a kid. And I just remember her as, well, actually, the first time I ever saw that picture of the woman, Grandma Moses, I think it is, rocking in a rocking chair, the image of that made me recall my great-great-grandmother, my great-grandmother. And she was somebody that I didn't really understand until I got to talking with my Aunt Peg, my father's sister. And it was Peg that would kind of fill in the gaps of my memory. You know, who was this one and who was that one and what was that about? And thank God that I've been allowed to so much enjoy her, my aunt, and her memory. I mean, she's 90 now, and her memory is just as good as it ever was. So she's made me understand the feeling of generations in my own family. So we would go there, and then we go to Uncle Charlie's, and Charlie also had, you know, farm sort of thing, but not dairy cows. And he had a weird situation that, well, I don't know how weird it was because we were kids. Because, see, my brother Phil would often go with me. He was a year younger than I. And so we would go over and see Uncle Charlie, and only a couple times maybe, but I remember he was baling hay. And, oh, my gosh, that was just such an amazing thing. But we never went into the house. I don't know who he was married to or anything else. I just know Uncle Charlie. One summer, my great-grandfather, my grandma's father, he was living with them because he had gotten to a point that he really, well, at that time, I don't even know that you put people in homes. He was, he was hysterical, actually. The guy could tell stories like you don't even believe. And I'm not even sure that we understood the stories, but the stories were so good in the way that he acted them out. He must have been just, maybe that's where I get my storytelling from. But he was amazing. And so that one summer I did get to interface with my great-grandfather. It was pretty awesome. We went from time to time up to see them. And that was another one of those weird, as a child, when you're looking at what the adults are presenting you, it's not easy to get a clear picture of what it is and who it is and all the other things. There's all this information coming into your head. And so, I don't know if everybody does this, so I've got mostly just snapshots of things. And again, my Aunt Peg was able to kind of put the snapshots into a video program to make them all have some continuity. And then Colleen has also gotten into it and is giving me even more information. But it just was, I think that it gave me the foundations of connecting life with history and time. And so I wanted to be a history major. When I got to the University of Massachusetts, that's what I went into. But that's a long story. I didn't realize I wanted to do that. And we'll get into that later too. But it was this love of history that I actually got because I was, you know, interacting with people who were history, my history. And of course, my mother and my father are my history. And while I don't have the obituaries for any of my grandparents, I do have them for my mom and dad. And obituaries are supposed to summarize your life, I suppose. I don't know how it can be done in such few paragraphs. But my brother Billy, who has been a professional newspaper writer for his adult life, I believe that he's the one that wrote these obituaries. So he probably has a better feel for both mom and dad. So if you'll indulge me here, I am going to read these to you so that you can see what my brother said, and it's a good summary of their lives. Okay, so we said mom was born in Cortland, New York, and that her father was Philip J., and her mother was Mary E. O'Connor, Wormald. She graduated from St. Mary's High School, okay, and dad was in the public schools. So I'm not sure if they knew each other when they were in school, to be honest with you. But she graduated in 1943. And then she went on to get a bachelor's degree from Syracuse University in 1947. And that was an interesting situation because she joined, let me try to think of what this was. The Army had a program where you could essentially enlist and get your degree in nursing and then go into the military, which was very similar to what I did. I got my degree, and then because of the degree, I was able to go directly into the position of second lieutenant in the Army. But Mom actually had a scholarship type, well, not scholarship, but the Army paid for her to get her bachelor's degree from Syracuse University, because that moved her into nursing at the same time. It was some kind of a special program that she went through. So Bill goes on, he says, she was a nurturer. Besides caring for her 10 children, there were dogs and cats and the neighborhood children who knew her as Mrs. Hopkins. Once she saved a boy who was drowning in a neighbor's pool. She welcomed many birds to her feeders in the winter and planted her herbs and tomatoes in the spring, enjoyed her many blossoming flowers in summer, and reaped her harvest in fall. After enabling her husband to build a successful business with her love and devotion, she embarked on her own career. A registered nurse, she earned a master's degree from Clark University and became director of continuing care at Hubbard Regional Hospital in Webster for many years. She retired in 1991. She was the director of the Hubbard Regional Hospital Guild and was a corporator of the hospital. Mrs. Hopkins was a member of St. Mark's Catholic Church in Oxford. She was a patient listener with a keen sense of humor. She had a writer's sense, and her notes to family and friends reflected her love of language. She enjoyed music and reading. Music. Mom actually learned how to play the piano only after she tried to get us to play the piano. And Jimmy got into it. Jimmy's a very excellent musician. But it was like, okay, if you kids don't want to learn how to play the piano, then I'm going to pay for me to learn how to play the piano. And she did. She did. I remember the day that she went out and got the new piano. It was this beautiful white, like, you know, one of those concert type of pianos, you know, that sort of reminds you of a Heart or Wings or something. And it was white. And it was small. It was a small version of it. And she'd keep it in the sunroom. That, to me, was how I grew up, you know, the piano in the sunroom. Not that I played it much or at all. But I did play guitar. Anyway. She enjoyed music and reading. Okay, now on the reading. I never knew this as a child. She would always be dragging us off to the library, which was awesome. But I never understood that she, in fact, was also getting her own books, and that after she'd deal with us all day, she'd go lay down and read and stay up until 2 o'clock or so in the morning reading. That was the way the woman stayed sane, I think. She did love reading. It kept her sane. She fostered those appreciations in her children with music lessons and instruments and many trips to the public library, which in her later years she supported in its efforts to build an addition. She got involved in some kind of Friends of the Library. That's what it was. Friends of the Library. And she and Dad worked very hard on that. She enjoyed walking, and upon retiring, she and her husband joined a gym, continuing her fitness routine until her recent illness. Not one to boast of her own achievements, she took quiet pride in her children and many grandchildren who felt her influence in many ways, from the birthday cards that always came to the smiles and hugs and the compassion and empathy that was always there. So that was the obituary I believe my brother Bill wrote for my mom. Here's my dad. Again, he graduated from Cortland High School, you know, the public school, in 43. And enlisted in the Army Air Force, earning his wings and becoming a military pilot. World War II ended before he saw service overseas. Following the war, he attended Syracuse University and moved to Massachusetts to work in the poultry feed industry. Now, by then, he had already married Mom. Apparently, they got involved after they had both graduated, and he had come back from, you know, his Army training. And then she got knocked up with me, to put it bluntly. And but Dad stood up, and he got married. I'm not sure that Mom didn't have some kind of question in her mind about did she make him marry her, because one day, decades later, they'd been married, well, at least 50 years. My Aunt Peg and I were over at their house, and we're sitting there talking, and all of a sudden, Mom comes in and says to us, "Well, I have pictures of Dad's girlfriends." And lo and behold, she had kept a box with pictures of my father's old girlfriends. So that leads me to believe that she had some kind of issue regarding Dad and his girlfriends and the fact that she got pregnant and she was the one that got him. Anyway, back to Dad's obituary. Next to his Wheelock Street home in Oxford, where he and Tilly raised their 10 children, he founded his own business, Philip L. Hopkins Incorporated. He designed and built poultry feed mills throughout New England and the Eastern Seaboard. To travel to the various construction sites, he earned his private pilot's license and bought a single-engine Cessna aircraft. He was a 40-year member of the Aircraft Owners and Pilots Association. Okay, I'm going to cut in here and tell you some more about Dad and his line. Yes, indeed, he did this. He flew out of the Oxford Airport, which was just a small, on the top of one of the hills was a small airport, and, you know, tiny little planes flew out of there. But he would also make some sizable trips and take Mom with him, like they go on vacation and stuff. So then Mom decides she's going to get her pilot's license. And I was in college by this time, and I'm thinking, huh, that's an odd turnaround, because she didn't seem to be at all pleased with any of this flying stuff. So she goes to school, she actually solos. And then she stopped, and I said, what was that all about? And she said, hey, if he dies of a heart attack on the plane, I want to be able to land it. Talk about a woman that, you know, has a sense of reality about her. Better learn how to land this thing in case the old man croaks while we're in the air. Oh, I love the woman. Okay, so Dad. Though he traveled often, he was active in the community of Oxford. He made a brief foray into politics, running for the schools committee in the mid-1960s and losing the election by 10 votes. Because Oxford was dealing with overcrowded schools, he served on the building committee that oversaw construction of the new high school that opened in 1968. Here's another little tidbit. That school, that high school that replaced the high school that I had gone to, I ended up teaching at. The one that my dad was very influential in building. Just a little aside. And, of course, my brothers and sisters, they ended up going there. Okay, he was active in St. Mark's Catholic Church, known to many in the congregation as a lecturer, and known to bishops and clergy alike for his active participation in Sierra International since 1957, of which he was a past president and past district governor. You know, I got to look into that. It's Sierra, S-E-R-R-A, International. I always, when Dad would talk about the Sierra Club, I thought he was talking about the Sierra Club, you know, the ones that were, at least at that time, involved in nature. And I always thought he was a nature buff. And then sometimes later I found out, no, that's not what it is. And it may be some kind of a secret organization. And I've totally spaced out on this. I'm looking at this. I should look at this. This is so funny. Actually, let me pause this. Okay, so I went and I looked it up, and I don't think it's a secret organization, that's for sure. But why am I so kind of still weirded out about it? Okay, I'm going to tell you what I found out. The Sierra Club is named after Franciscan missionary Junipero Sierra, the founder of many of the California missions. It was founded in 1935 in Seattle by a small group of Catholic laymen who saw the need to foster vocations to religious life, both by recruiting vocations and by supporting those religious in their active careers. Formally recognized by the Holy See as the Global Lay Apostolate for Vocations in the Catholic Church, Sierra is a voluntary association of some 2,000 Catholic laymen and Catholic women called Serens, S-E-R-R-E-N-S. But this is a 2,000 is a 2018 number, and my mother was not a part of the Sierra Club, so I'm not sure that when my dad was there that women were even there. So I'm just telling you what they're saying now. The Sierra Clubs are known for worldwide for their effort to foster and affirm Catholic vocations to the ministerial priesthood and vowed religious life. Boy, I'm having a hard time saying these words. Syrians value not only their work, but also the sense of community they receive from knowing that they are not alone in their dedication to the men and women who have dedicated their life in ministry and service to our church. Well, we know the history. Kind of spooky. I'm talking Catholic priest history, pedophilia, that sort of thing. None of us would admit knowing it. I didn't know it. I'm sure most people did not know the depth of depravity within the church. But I know for a fact that some adults did know and did nothing for a very long time. So another subject we could get into at some point. But I doubt that my father seemed to be very loyal to the church throughout his life, which is odd because he was not he wasn't brought up Catholic. He became Catholic when he married my mom, so he could marry her in the Catholic Church, which, you know, Grandpa Phil, her father, would not have seen it any other way. But interestingly enough, my dad's mom, Grandma, she was always so, I mean, she loved this guy so much, my dad, that she also converted to Catholic. So I was responsible for the change of religion for at least two people. They went from whatever it was to Catholic. And Dad, you know, did get very involved in the church, as you can see. So, so each of these clubs is part of a vast network of clubs, districts, regions, and national councils. And they do things like spiritual growth and enrichment through the deepening of your faith and increasing knowledge of the church's teachings. Wow, let's join that group. Education, study of current events happening in the public square in light of our Christian principles. That sounds kind of interesting. Service projects and social activities, association with priests. Oh, yeah, okay. Religious and Catholic men and women who are faith-filled, dedicated, and generous, all sharing the ideals of church and Sierra Club and working toward a common goal. Well, God bless you, Dad. God bless all those other people that, you know, really wanted to uphold their faith, to actually demonstrate the faith in action. And I so implore you for having that kind of dedication to a religion and a spiritual way of being. However, as we have found out since then, it was not what you suspected it was. Your reality was not the real reality. And I know my dad finally got to that. I know my mom did. They still went through the, you know, process of going to church and acting it out, but did they really religion it? really? Did they really believe it in their hearts of hearts? I'm not so certain. I think that a lot of people, once they get hooked into a religion, they continually go along with the religion, even if they may be having, you know, vast doubts about it. So we were in the process of talking about my dad, and that's when we got to the Sierra Club thing, and now we know about that. And I did that not only for myself, but for anybody else that might have had a dad, or apparently now a mom, in Sierra Club, and you didn't know what the heck it was, because it wasn't about nature. Phil was also known to many in Oxford for his volunteer efforts at Hubbard Regional Hospital in Webster, of which he was past president and a corporate. He was also for many years on the board of directors at Webster 5 Cent Savings Bank. His friends in business were many, and he was a past president of the Webster Dudley Oxford Chamber of Commerce, which also honored him as with its Man of the Year Award. Let me tell you about the Man of the Year Award. Okay, he's getting it. It's a big thing. I decide that I'm going to go up there and participate in whatever this thing was because I really didn't know. And we go to a very nice club, and there's a lot of people there. I don't know most of them. I'm there sitting there with my family. And I don't think Phil was there, but I think the rest of us were. And as they got up and they talked about all these wonderful things my father were doing, us kids, we just kept looking at each other like, is this, they're talking about our dad? What the heck is this? We had no clue that he was so active in so many aspects of the neighborhood, a three-town neighborhood. And it was just an eye-opener because I saw my father walk out the door a lot of nights and never really questioned where he was going. But apparently he was going out and making a good name for himself. But it was strange. That was a strange event, I must have to say. He lived an active life and reveled in what he did. He took up sailing and was most at home on Webster Lake. That was a big lake that Dad and Mom bought a piece of property. It had a nice little cottage on it. Oh, it was a cute little thing. But obviously not big enough for Dad. And so he tore that down and he built this monstrosity of a house for the lake. I mean, it was one of the bigger houses on the lake. But we spent a lot of very, very, you know, quality time there. And I know he did that so that he could sail his boat anytime he basically wanted to, because the lake was just, you know, 15 minutes away from where we were living. He was most at home on Webster Lake on a breezy summer day. He even, for a short time, owned a yacht building company. He fought diabetes and heart disease for many years, exercising regularly at a gym until just a few months ago, and living well beyond all medical expectations. He enjoyed telling stories, of which there were many, and he had a salesman's knack for remembering faces and names. He took great pride in his contributions to the community and was a familiar face around town. So that is my dad's life. And I got to tell you, him and Mom, they began doing the gym thing. And when it was my 50th birthday, and we go to Boston, my friend Cindy went with me. We go up to Boston, and we had to do some walking through the city of Boston. My mother and father walked us under the ground. I was 50 years old, and they were, 22 years older than I was, and they were just, we couldn't keep up with them. So the fact that they were so healthy into the age of, you know, mid-80s, 86, I think Dad died, that, you know, it's because they took the time and did it together. Dad continued it even after Mom passed. But the thought of getting out there and going to a gym is not something I'm going to do, so. But I do honor them. That was quite the thing. And, of course, Bill does mention that Dad liked to tell stories, and I tell you that I watched the man. He was a great storyteller. I've learned a lot about him from that. So we're kind of like, I think we're kind of at the hour mark here. Pretty much so. That's my family. That's Mom and Dad. And I'm actually going to take a break here. I probably won't come right back and do any more on this hour, because I don't know where I'm going to go in the second hour. I just listened to Dolly Howard doing her show, Dolly Shares. And she did. She was like, oh, I don't know if any of this is interesting to people, because it's just her thoughts. And, you know, she talks about things that are happening to her at the time. But I got to tell you, I really enjoy her show. And I hope that you're finding this at least as, you know, interesting and entertaining as I find always. So I'm going to put on the theme song that we're working for this show. And it's Imagine Dragons, Thunder. Be back in an hour. Well, the recording will be back in an hour. I might be back in a couple of days.
Just a young gun with a quick fuse. I was uptight, wanna let loose. I was dreaming of bigger things and wanna leave my old life behind. Not a yes sir, not a follower. Fit the box, fit the mold, have a seat in the foyer. Take a number. I was lightning before the thunder.
Thunder.
Classes while I was scheming for the masses. Who do you think you are? Dreaming about being a big star. They say you're basic, they say you're easy. You're always riding in the backseat. Now I'm smiling from the stage while you were clapping in the nosebleeds.
Well, I really do love that song. You know, like I say, energies. And that's what got me back here tonight, because it's been 2 days since I did the first hour, and now it's 2 days later, and I was really kind of fatiguing, and I said, oh, what the heck, and I put that on, and I danced, and got my energy back, and moved energy, and so we're going to go on with our story. What is our story? Well, we're talking about my family line. And as you can see, I came from basic, middle class, hardworking people who loved life, had lots of friends, good family. Oh, there was drama. Of course there was drama. Humans seem to like drama. But it was good. It was good. And yet, behind the scenes, behind the reality that they had structured with their thoughts, this is what's real. But behind that reality, there was like a cancer. A cancer that was being manipulated by human beings, maybe. Who knows? but by somebody, and it was secrets. And they contrived to put other human beings into a state of mind control. That's as simple as it is, mind control. Now, let's just consider all this. Now, you people that have been listening to me, you know for a fact that there are many different ways that this mind control program was initiated. Who's to fault? Is it my mother and my father, my grandmother and grandfather, or their great-grandparents for not having seen what was happening? No. It was none of our faults. Because human beings, in my opinion, want to be trusting and believe that people live by the golden rule, do unto others as you would have done unto yourself. They cannot conceive of the things that we have seen. And yet, I remember an episode with my dad. Now, during the 70s, well, Kent State happened. Okay, now, Kent State happened in the May of 1970. And American military forces in the form of National Guard fired upon students at Kent State. I don't remember the death toll, 4 or 5, I don't remember. But I do remember what happened to me and the people at the universities at the time. I can only say that because that's where I was. That's where I was in touch with their reality. And so many things started happening that were basically of an economic war. Vietnam War was on economic problems. Labor unions were getting involved in it. Nothing compared to what it is now, honestly. So, but we knew there was problems, and we were trying to address those problems. And one of those ways was to protest our graduation, at our graduation. I was at the University of Massachusetts. So it was decided that students wouldn't go to the graduation ceremony. We would not show up, and, you know, it would be a display of, I guess, protest and consolidated movement. So I talked to my father. I call him. I don't know why I wasn't talking to my mother. I normally only talk to her, but I was talking to him. And I'm trying to explain to him why I don't want them to come out to the university, because I'm not even going to go to the damn graduation. And my father, God bless him, listened to me, didn't say anything, just listened to my ranting and raving like you know I can do. And then he said to me, "Honey, I wish what you were saying to me that you're going to do would make any difference at all. But it won't." And it was the way that he said it. It was like, this guy knows there's problems, but he doesn't think anything can be done about them. And it sort of tripped me, I think, because I think I started listening to my father instead of everybody else and what was happening around me, because I did go to that graduation because I thought, no, Dad's right. It's not going to make a damn bit of difference. I just knew it, that he was right. But I did know that me going to that graduation, them being able to go and see me graduate, that was important. That was important to them. And it should be important to me. Because some of these fights are so big, you're not going to win. But if you keep yourself in balance and say, okay, that is a big battle, I'm not going to win. This is a little battle. I'm going to piss off my parents. They're going to be upset. They're not going to have that good, oh, I spent my money and my daughter is now graduated. And I'm so proud of her, but mostly I'm proud of me because I was able to do that for her. So I said, yeah, I'll go to the graduation, because I wanted to support my mother and father, because I knew that that would be something of meaning. Whereas me not showing up was probably not going to make a damn bit of difference anywhere, anytime, anyplace. But I think my parents did have a deeper understanding of things that were wrong. But they had no way of even attempting to make corrections. They weren't bad enough. We talked about the Catholic Church in the previous hour. Did my father come to understand the evils of the church? Absolutely. Absolutely. One of the priests in our parish was... No, I'm sorry. He wasn't a priest at the time. He was a lay person who was... I forget what their title in the church was, but they were basically like old altar boys helping out the priests and everything. And this guy, he said that he wanted to... he indicated that he wanted to be a priest. And the head priest in the church told my father, he said, over my dead body. Because that man, that old, old priest that used to scare the crap out of us, but... I still, to this day, think he was a very moral and God-blessed human being. But even he knew what was happening in the church. And all he could say was, over my dead body. And the guy ended up being a Catholic priest, and he ended up molesting children, and he ended up being... I don't know what happened to him. But my father, as far as I know, because I had left the church when I was freshman in high school, I mean college, and I had been one of the most devout Catholics you can even imagine. I was obnoxious as a kid. I made my mother drive me to Mass every day during Lent. That woman was a saint. She did it. Only I was the only one that wanted to, you know, I please my mother. But I don't know the depth of understanding that my dad and my mom's generation had regarding the true evil, and I don't think they can go there. My Aunt Peg, she's 90 years old, and I don't think that she can go there. I mean, the biggest scare that anybody's gotten of that, of those people that think reality is stable, that's the dog, he must have a flea, that reality is stable and that you know what it is and you can be, it's predictive. All of those people, like my aunt, my dad, my mom, they couldn't possibly think of any way to make changes because there was no instrument to do so. We have the internet, and that has made all the difference in the world. I'm talking to the entire world. We've got friends all over the world. We've got family all over the world. The human family is our family. And the internet draws us to be able to talk to one another, to become aware of the problems, and to discuss solutions. The generation before us didn't have that. So, my generation didn't have it for the most part. We didn't have internet. Remember that the internet really got going in the 90s. That's when people started finding out AOL and getting on, and you're in this, you think that the AOL is the internet. You have no concept that AOL is just a slice of the internet. You know, but that's where it started. Everybody was AOL. And now Reverend Lee Brown is the only person I know that has an AOL account. I didn't even know they were still in existence. But she's got an email AOL account. Probably a lot of you people don't even know what AOL was. For most of us, that was the internet, AOL, when we started out. So the internet has given us something that previous generations did not have, a way of talking to one another in a very meaningful way. Yes, there's a tremendous amount of garbage out there, but hey, you found us, didn't you? We're not garbage. We're honest to goodness, just regular people trying to tell our stories. So when we look at ourselves and our families, you're going to confront people who just can't even, they don't even want to hear what you're saying. They can't. Their minds have been blown. Don't judge them. Because that's the glue that's holding everything together. Their belief in that reality. Reality is what you think it is. And hey, when I started out, and I saw how, well, this is exactly what happened to me. I started out without the internet, doing research on my own. Much of it not from books, but from newspapers and magazines. And I was led to certain information. I did original, research in that I was reading the Warren Commission report and figuring out what does this really mean, what does it really say. There were a tremendous number of us that were doing the same thing. I was not alone. But it was individuals searching for the truth. The truth that we were starting to uncover was very unnerving because it went so contrary to everything else that we had been taught to believe. We see the Catholic Church and the Vatican as not being this wonderful organization of loving. No, it was something that was, in many cases, you could flat out say evil. It was promoting, you know this story, I don't even like to think about it, you know, what they've done. And it continues. And maybe when I'm in a different mood, I'll really go after the entire religious foundations of the world and take it down. Oh, God, they're falling apart by themselves. Everybody is leaving churches because they're realizing, wow, if you want to stop a movement like the message from Jesus or the message from Muhammad or the Hindu philosophy of life or if you want to destroy it, stop it, don't let it move, then take all its energy away by organizing it and making a religion. You know, that's when the wind comes out of the sail and everything starts to stop and then people start to control. And I want to do it this way and I want to do it that way. Well, back in, like we talked about in the first hour, back when you had this country with a completely open space, there was nothing there except land. Oh, well, there's those Indians, but we can get rid of them. So, but you got all this space here. And you can move out, and you can be your own person. And if you don't like what the pastor is saying, then just go down the road, put up another church, and get on with life. That's freedom. That's free. Well, not for the Indians. Not for the Indians, but for the settlers, it was like, you know, yes, it was hard. You had to work hard. You had to clear land. You had to build. But you know, nobody was telling you how to think. And so, you know, that kind of society that ended up having, you know, the American Revolution was a society based on basically capitalism in that, you know, if it's needed and you got it, you get to sell it. But it's also the concept of the freedom of the mind to think and to be able to decide, you know, who is God, what is God, and how does God work, which is fundamental to so many lives. I think we're all asking for the same, we're getting, you know, wondering about the same thing, is like, who's this God character? What are we doing here? Why are we here? What is this life thing? You know, I mean, all of those questions fundamentally are answered by somebody, and then it becomes a religion. It was only that person's story. We don't see it that way. But they were good stories. They were good teaching devices. They were there for your spiritual development, and then they were warped by whoever was in control of the religion. So who knows what any of them really said. So we've got this religious dogma that, like I say, by the time they get here, doesn't really hold because you could just pick up and leave and go someplace. But that's certainly not true today. We know how much brainwashing goes on. If we can't think, if we're not aware of what's happening around us, then we're not going to know that we can get solutions. You got to know you got a problem before you look for the solution. And that's what we try to do here. That's what we try to do. And another thing I want to point out. I do not come from some E.T. line of blood. I do not have, even, well, I think we all have royal blood on us in a certain way, because it's all the same. The people that were, seem to be behind this, and there's layers, it's like onions, you know, there's layers and layers. But you've got this one group of people who do seem to think that they are special and basically above humanity. And this all has to do with the bloodline. The bloodline. Boy, this dog is annoying. Now he stops. Now he's drinking water. Can you hear all this? I could shut this off, but hey, that's my life. My dog drinking water, scratching fleas, and me on the computer. And he drinks a lot when he starts drinking, so it'll be a bit. Okay, I'm just going to go on with the story. We'll forget about him. I could cut this out, but hey, every time I stop this, it takes more time. When I look at my family and the families of most people throughout the entire world, you think in terms of family tree and genetics and ancestry. But I saw the most amazing, I've told this story before, I saw this most amazing documentary about a guy, oh, he was probably in his 40s, and he had taken blood samples that had been collected all over the world. And the blood samples were collected by a doctor who, I don't know what his job was, but he went around and collected all this stuff before DNA. Now, this other guy comes along, and he's a protege of this other guy, and but now they've got DNA. So he takes all this blood samples from all over the world, and they start testing it. And what they found in their testing was a basic map of the way that humanity moved through the earth. Now, in Massachusetts, they moved from the coast and they went into, you know, through Massachusetts into New York and then all over the country for many different reasons. And the thing of it is that human beings, when they started out, according to this worldwide blood sampling and the DNA testing that they did on it, they all started out in Africa with a small tribe. And from that small tribe thing, they moved out of Africa, Central Africa, to populate the whole world. And they were able, because they had all this DNA, to be able to track this movement. Because, you know, we talk about genetics and family genetics and stuff. Well, Colleen and her ancestry look at me and her family. She says that, because her family also ended up in the New York area. And she says, we're cousins many times over. She said, there's connections all over with all these people, because you got a small group of people that are intermarrying. So there can't be that much change in the genetics. And in fact, that's exactly what they found on a worldwide basis when they were doing this study. Because there are very few changes in the DNA over the entire history of modern man. Now, what this means is that we're all basically family. They took and they could find markers. They called them markers. And it's some change, like a genetic change, that they do call markers, and they track it. So all of a sudden you're in, let's say, India. And in India, you have you're finding blood that's got a different marker in it. You hadn't seen that marker before. But now that marker becomes a way of tracking, because you see that particular marker move down into, you know, the Middle East and all the way to Australia. And so there's these little teeny markers that they were able to track, and it showed changes not in the genetics per se, but in the environment. They were moving into different environments, and their DNA was responding, mutating slightly. So what are these slight mutations that we see? Well, some of them went to the north and up into the bellies of Russia and into Siberia. And they sat there for a very long time without seeming too much motion out of there. But then they started moving towards the European area. Those people that moved to the north began to get lighter skin. Okay, because now they're in an area where they're in colder weather, and your body needs that darker skin to pull in the rays with the sun that's weaker than it is in the middle, you know, like around the equator of the earth. So they began to change. They began to get hairier because now they've got cold things happening. And a whole lot of other minute, and so this is the, you know, the evolution of, you know, survival of the fittest and all that concept. That's where that all comes from, that you adapt to your environment by making certain little teeny weeny little DNA changes. And it, so the conclusion of this entire study was that we're all one family. And as they were tracking this man, this documentary, he went to the places that they were talking about, where the changes occurred. He took himself quite a trip around the world. And as they were doing it, they would say, okay, part of the family went up into the Siberia and became reindeer peoples, but then the Siberian, is it Bering? I don't remember what it is. The strait right there in Alaska. There was a land bridge, so to speak, that went from Russia into Alaska. And there was a great migration of people at that time that, well, great migration, I mean, we're just talking a few hundred, maybe, thousand, maybe. You know, I mean, we're not talking millions and billions yet. But they come into North America now, and he met people that were there in Siberia and talked to them, and they took film of these people. Then he went over and he met with the Hopis, and the similarities in the way these people acted and the very physical way that they looked like definitely family of these reindeer keepers. And he went and he did this, you know, throughout the world, showing that, you know, people that are in Siberia really look like people that are Hopi Indians, because we all move around, but we've all got basically the same genetic mixture. We're not any different from one another. We're all basically the same. I mean, we are the same. There are just minor changes. So how do they get control? They make us think that we're different, that we're special. You know, I've got more money than you've got. I've got more of this than you've got. And they keep perpetuating the separation of humanity. And it's my belief that, no, we're all family. You know, we shouldn't need to prove anything to family. I know there's these sibling rivalries, I'm better than you are, and maybe it's ingrained in humanity. But I suspect it's more because we have a society that says you have to be better than somebody else. Why? Somebody has to be the leader. Why? Somebody has to control. Why? This is my recurring question. Why do you think you should do? Why do you want to do this? And I really don't know, but I really don't care at this point. It's just got to change. It's just got to change. And where does the change start? It changes. The change starts with each and every one of us. Before we can change the minds of society, we have to change our own minds. We have to stop thinking of ourselves as in competition with somebody else. We have to think of ourselves as being equal to everybody else, who deserves as much as anybody else. We're all in this together. If I've got more and you need, why wouldn't I give it to you? You know, for fear in the future that sometime I'm going to need, well, if you've got a society that says help the people that are in need, then I don't have to worry, do I? Then I can help everybody because I know that if I do get in trouble, somebody's going to help me. It's not that complicated. But if we keep telling each other, well, I'm better than you. I've got better shoes. I've got better this. I live in a better house. I'm better than you. All we're doing is creating torture. Torture for everything around us. Because you keep feeding the energy of hierarchy. Somebody's better than somebody. No. Nobody is any better than anybody else. Sorry, I've been around for a long time, and there are people that you enjoy more. There are people that you get along with better. But that's because these people are brainwashed. The ones that you don't like. But you got to start with yourself. You know, if you're coming to us and you're listening to me and the people of this station, we're telling you you're special. And you are special. Everybody's special. But if you will realize it and start to treat yourself as if you're special, just because you're human, not that you're better, you're special. Everybody's special. You got your own place and space in the universe, and you're here for some reason. If you just realize that and say, I don't have to listen to the bullies. I don't have to listen to my husband or my wife or my mother or my father who's telling me I'm less than or that I should be. I want to be who I am, my authentic self. But if you don't know who your authentic self is, well, that's the problem. Right there. Because you never talk to yourself. You never say, Nancy, what do you want to do? Do you want to go to the movies or do you want to stay home? Do you want to go out to dinner? Do you really want to go out to dinner or do you want to make something here? Ask yourself what you want to do. And people say, oh, you got to compromise. Do you? Because every time you want to do something, that it feels right for you. I bet there's a lot of other people that think the same way, but they're not saying anything. Yes, and sometimes you have to go to dinner even though you don't want to go to dinner because you're making the choice. Well, I could be really kind of like not go to dinner, but then I'm not with the people that want to go to dinner. So I'm going to go to dinner even though I don't want to go to dinner because I want to be with those people. You're making a choice. If you don't make choices, you will never know who you are because you never said, oh, I want to do that, but I got to do this because I like these people. One time when I was babysitting, my sister Lori apparently took a glass bottle and broke it in the driveway. And so the other kids ran in. Now, Lori is 15 years younger than I am. She was the next to the last of 10. And so the kids run in and say, oh, Lori broke this bottle. And I said, well, have Lori come in the house. And so Lori gets there, and she's about 5 years old. And I said, why'd you break the bottle? Well, all of a sudden, now this little kid is really kind of uncomfortable. And she starts to squirm, and I said, why'd you break the bottle? And she starts squirming more, and I can see her mind is working, you know. And finally she looks at me, and she says, I don't know, and she burst into tears. And I said, wait. I said, listen to me, please, you know, don't do this. I said, no matter what you do in life, you got to know why you did it. It doesn't matter if it's right or wrong. You got to know why you did it. Because if it's wrong, you got to know why you did it to know what it was that made you do that. To make the change. To say, oh, that didn't work. I shouldn't do that. Now, I know why she broke the bottle. She was a five-year-old and wanted to know what it was like to throw a bottle and see if it broke. It was no big deal. So, I guess it was maybe 5 years ago. My sister and I were together and talking about something or other, and she said, well, the most important lesson I ever learned in my life was the one you taught me. And I said, what? And she said, do you remember? And she starts relating this story. And she said to me, she said, I can guarantee you that I never did anything that I did not know why. And this is a very successful lady. Very successful. And that became the key to so much of her ability to go through life in a way that, sure, pisses off some people because she really does want to tell you what she's thinking. But she's so kind, and she's a nurse, and she takes care of everybody, and she's just a very, very well, stable, and fun person. Through most of my life, she was the most fun person I know. She was like my daughter. We had all that time between us. But I do want to say something else about, you know, who we are and what we are. Because one of the things that they push on us is that, well, you got these genetics, it's this family line, and your father was a bastard, so you'll probably be a bastard too. And, you know, all those people are white trash. They never, you know, all of these things that come to you because of your family environment. Let's put it that way. Well, when I was in college, I had to take, I was in phys ed for 2 years, then I went into history. But in phys ed, I had to take courses that were designed to kind of like make you aware of teaching, the adolescent psychology, that sort of thing. And sociological courses, and I don't remember more. But I did take a course that was talking about what is the prevalent control mechanism over personality development. Is it your genetics? Because we know, I've seen people who were like my father and his grandson, my nephew, who's named Connor. Connor and my father, if you look at pictures of them at the same age, you wouldn't know which one was who. They look identical. And in many ways, Connor exhibited some of my dad's personalities, but was basically the physical. You know, I mean, he was extremely both. Well, I'm going to say that probably it was the physical resemblance that was so stark. You know, but again, Connor was as a kid, he kind of scared me because he always seemed to be, you know, a little bit watching things a little bit more than most kids do, and never knew what was going on in this guy's head. And he's brilliant. He's absolutely brilliant. Music-wise, just taught himself how to play the piano, and then tells his mother that they want him to do a solo at the Christmas party for the school. And she says, a solo on what? She didn't even know she knew he was kind of playing the piano, but she was so busy, she wasn't paying any attention to it. And he said, the piano. And she said, oh, okay. You know, so she goes to this thing where her son is going to solo on the piano. And she hasn't heard him doing a tremendous amount of practicing, you know. I mean, I guess he was practicing when she wasn't around. I don't know what it was. But she goes and he gets out there and he's on the stage by himself and she gets her little camera and she goes up so she can get closer and be able to take a picture. And this kid started playing the piano. And she's telling me this story. She said, Nancy, she said, it was so out of body for me because I'm listening to this incredible music and I'm staring at my son who is playing it, and I didn't even know he played. But it was extraordinary, she said, and I started crying. It was such a moving, but I'm thinking, well, it's me, it's because he's my son. And she's going through all this while he's doing the music. And then he finishes, and there was absolute silence for longer than you would normally expect it. And then suddenly, and she was like, she turns around to see what's happening because nobody's clapping or anything, you know. And she turns around, and everybody was crying. And finally, they got over it, and they clapped, and they, oh, my God, this guy is amazing, right? That kind of ability to pull up something as deep in him as music. Now, my mother loved music, but she didn't seem to have a flair for it. My brother Jimmy is very good at it, but still, you know. And this is what I'm getting to, is my mother. I was told that you either have the genetics or you have the environment. And the environment can cause a child, you know, to take on a certain personality, or just genetics, you know, indicates the personality traits. But here's my mom, and she's had 10 kids. And we got, you know, when I was in college, I would talk to her about all sorts of weird subjects. And we were talking about this, or I was talking about this. And my mother's listening to me. She's driving the car. She's listening to me. She had no other decision. She couldn't walk away. She's driving the car. But anyway, she says to me, look, she says, I've had 10 kids. And I'm telling you, it's neither genetics nor environment. All 10 of you came from the same parents and were brought up in the same household. And every one of you has a distinctly different personality. She said, but how I know that this is true is that I could see your personalities virtually within a couple of weeks of you being born. And she gives me this example. She says, like your brother Jimmy. Of all of you, your brother Jimmy is the one that is the most stubborn, that causes me more heartbreak than any of you. Jimmy was a little bit of a troublemaker. He turned out fine, but when he was a kid, he was in trouble. Well, he took LSD and ended up getting strychnine because of the LSD and strychnine chemistry, too much, and there was too much strychnine, and he ended up in the hospital and almost died. That's the kind of thing that Jim would get into. But my mom is, this is before all this happened, because we're still kind of young, but she said, when Jimmy was only a few days old, he spat at me. And I said, he spat at you? You mean he spit in your face? And she said, exactly. And I kind of chuckled and I said, don't do that, Jimmy. And he spit in my face again. This is a kid, she's saying, she's yelling at me. This is a kid. He's days old. And he's spitting at me? And she said she felt that she would have to hurt that child to keep that child from spitting at her. She could see this belligerence in him, this, you know, stubbornness that don't tell me what to do. As a kid. As a teeny little infant. And that's exactly what his personality went on to do. That's who he became. Now he's wonderful. I mean, he's like a phenomenal guy. He grew out of that, whatever that was. But she was firmly convinced that the personality that shows up in a child was there, was well developed before it ever got there. And Mom never talked to me about reincarnation. She wouldn't even talk to me about anything, really. Except, you know, these brief things. That's why I can remember them so clearly, because it wasn't all of those that, you know, really, wow, that's an interesting conversation. Because mostly she was too busy to talk to anybody, as far as I could figure. But this concept that you have of, if she's seeing a personality so early in life, I would think it would be easy for her to think in terms of reincarnation. Yet she never, every time I'd bring it up, she would, no, she's not going to go there. And then I find out from my nephew, Connor, that she would have conversations with Connor about reincarnation. I didn't know this until after she passed. So, I don't know about you guys, but I'm not sure that I knew my mother. I think in the end, I actually probably knew my dad a little better than I did my mom. Because they're individuals. Because they're seeing reality from their vantage point. But mom said it wasn't genetics and it wasn't environment. We're all absolutely special. If you think you're going to get some disease because you have some, your family has a genetic propensity for it, you're setting up a reality that could lead you there. Now, there was another case, this woman, she damaged her leg. It was some kind of an accident. I think it was a horse thing. But she very seriously damaged her leg to the point that they wanted to cut it off. And she was highly metaphysical. And she said, this doesn't even read right with me. And for some reason, because I don't remember all the details. I don't know that the detail. I think somebody told me this story, not the person that said it. No, I think she did say it. Maybe she just didn't get into it. But she was talking in terms of, why is this happening to me? There's nothing in my metaphysical life that indicates that this should be happening. So is it something else? And she started looking at her ancestry. And I think it's because she remembered that there was like a grandfather, I think, that had lost his leg. And so she went back and she found out that like every generation, somebody in the family lost their leg. And it went back for, you know, quite a few generations. And being a metaphysician, she looked at this and she said, well, this is some kind of a weird family curse. Now, she didn't know if it was genetics or what it was. But as a metaphysician, she said, this stops right here and now. I don't want my children going through this. And so she healed herself metaphysically, energetically, instead of cutting the leg off. But I found that fascinating. It was something that I'd never really thought of. Wow. You know, somebody every generation loses part of their leg. I mean, like, what? What is this about? So there's all sorts of, let's say, not so much subconscious, but unknown factors that are in existence about genetics and about karma. I don't think of karma in the way that most people do, but just sort of like thought forms that follow the family. You know, it's like the grandfather gets his leg taken off and he goes, oh my God, it's the family curse. And because you've said family curse, now you've cursed the rest of the family. And these are things that we don't realize we're doing, is that we agree to contracts. And we've talked about contracts many, many times on many shows. That you actually make contracts with a certain situation. Oh, I've got glaucoma in my family. Oh, well, chances are I'm going to get glaucoma. You just made a contract to have the glaucoma. You know, I have glaucoma in my family, but I don't have glaucoma. The eye doctors, they keep putting me in there and they keep testing me because I've got glaucoma in my family, and so I might have glaucoma. But I've never gone over the pressure points. I've never been diagnosed with it. Because I'm not going to get glaucoma. I mean, it's just, why? Why would I do that? Because my mother had it? Because my brother had it? Because the others are got the symptoms of it. Nah, I ain't gonna. Why would I do that to my eyes? But there are a lot of contracts that are made that we don't even know about, like this woman with a curse on her family. You know? Oh, no. Because people were accepting these contracts and then thinking them into real. And because it was interfacing with the next generation, boom, 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 boom. Anybody who is confronting these thoughts of, well, I'm going to get or I have to be because of things that are outside of you, you're being programmed by your environment, and that's not you. We have to look at reality and think in terms of this reality that I see is mine and mine alone, because it's my place and space. Every time you change position, you change your perspective on what's happening. Therefore, you're changing your vision of reality. And if this is true, then you have complete control over the space in front of you, the reality in front of you. And if you don't like it, there's nobody that can change it except you. Now, I sound like I'm preaching because I'm saying you, you, you. But I've gone through this. I'm not telling you this stuff because somebody told me. I haven't followed anybody or been in a church or, you know, I read a lot of different people, but I take what resonates with me. I don't have a guru, whatever they call it. And believe me, I looked for many, 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 many years looking for somebody that could tell me the secrets. And the fact of the matter is that you'll find people that tell you some of the secrets. They tell you what you need to know at that moment in time. But that doesn't mean that they've got all the answers for every point in time. They had the answers for when you needed it. Don't be fearful to say, you know, I just am not resonating with this guy or girl anymore. Walk away. Find somebody else that you are. Or better yet, talk to yourself. What do you want? What do you think? I mean, we spend so much time listening to what other people think. What do you think? Most people don't give themselves a chance to think. When I had to do all that driving back and forth to work, and I'd be in the car for like an hour, I'd watch all these people who are talking on their phones. Now, that was when you could still see him holding the phone. But before that, when you watched the traffic, you would see people who were, in many ways, kind of zoned out. And I had a good home life. It was all right at the office, too. The drive was terrible, but being there wasn't too bad. It was pretty good, actually. I had some friends. But when I would talk to people, they would say more than one time, I mean, many, many people made this comment that, because I was always, oh my God, I hate driving. And they'd go, oh, I kind of like driving. And I go, why would you like driving? Because it's the only time I'm alone. It's the only time that they had to be by themselves, to talk to themselves, or just veg out. When they were at work, they were always people, 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 doing. And then they'd have that drive home. For them, it was the interlude of connecting with themselves. Because then they'd go home and they'd have to be this other person, the person that lives at that house. And that was really telling to me. You know, so many people were uncomfortable because they never had the time to be alone. And then the cell phones come along. And now instead of me looking and seeing zoned out people that are just like, oh, I'm by myself. Oh, I don't have to listen to anybody. I can just listen to the radio, or I can just veg out, not think about anything, or maybe think about something that I have to do. But most of the time they didn't even do that. It was this time of silence, I'm by myself, oh my God, I love this. You know? And then the cell phones come along, and all of a sudden everybody's talking to a cell phone. Everybody says, no, cell phone, cell phone, cell phone, cell phone. And I don't even know why they're not crashing. So, this concept of being by ourselves scares a lot of people. It doesn't scare me, I love it. And maybe that's because I came from a family of 10 where it was always very hectic. But I think it's because I learned to live within a family of 10. That you're always in a group, but you were always your own self, your own personality. And again, I'll go back to the fact that we were not brainwashed as kids because there were too many of us and too few adults around. So they kept us fed and clean and clothed and got us to school and did all the things that they needed to do in a very 3D way. But they never got into our heads. They never told us that we had to do this and become this. Never. Never heard it. Never heard it in the school. Never heard it at home. Now remember, this, I grew up, you know, I'm talking about the 50s, early 60s. That none of that was really there, at least from my hometown, you know, Oxford. I suppose there are other places, other families, but I know that when the adults are there and they've got the one-to-one on the kid, or they've only got a few kids, and they start getting in their heads, you know, they start buying them toys that are, you know, medical things, doctor, you got to be a doctor, or, you know, all these things, and they've got such high hopes for their kids. And they control them. Well, you don't need to continue that way. You don't need to do what your parents told you to do. You know, you need to know what you want to do. So, it looks like I'm getting close to an hour here. Yes, indeedy. I hope you're enjoying this. I've been told by a few people that they actually like to hear me talking. Derek said, yeah, he says, well, I listened to it, and he said, I kind of get lost in the stories. He said, before I know it, an hour's gone. So I hope you guys got lost in the stories. Nothing very, you know, in your face or wonderful this time, but I just want you to, because I'm trying to, let's say, put on the record some of the truths about my generation, the 60s generation. You know, how did we grow up? Who were we when we were little? We were just either being brainwashed because we had too many adults around us telling us how to think, or we were lucky enough to be allowed to live in a community where even the kids that, you know, one child here and a couple kids here, they were always out with us. You know, they were at our house. We always played the games together. It was a neighborhood type of thing. But their parents weren't really controlling them because their parents weren't really controlled at the time. Society was just getting going. But I'll tell you where it really got going. It was when we scared the shit out of them because we said no more Vietnam War. And maybe we'll talk about that next time. Who knows? I so appreciate you listening. Be safe. And be blessed. And we'll see you next time.
I was lightning before the thunder.
Thunder, thunder, thunder.
You have been listening to Reality Insight with Nancy Hopkins, produced by Cosmic Reality Radio. Thank you for listening.
Thunder, feel the thunder. Lightning and the thunder. Thunder, feel the thunder.